Hello, Mr. Kanpur and Mr. Ashish. Welcome to IIT Kanpur. And now we would like to start an interview for how to think about your standard and how to think about it.
No, first question is I want to ask about your startup. Why startup? And what motivated you for it? You have to take my perspective in this current IIT Kanpur product evolution and post graduation from IIT Kanpur. If you went for startup, what motivated you?
All starts about my interest in research more than working into a corporate job. So that's why I ended up for any job while I was in IIT Bombay. And then I joined IIT Kanpur for my master's. Because I carried out a research project over here. And so during that time, I met in Ankit from Janus. So Ankit is our founder and CEO of our company. He was having this idea to do something with the flower waste that gets generated every day in amount of tons from our temples across India. So they decided to start something at his native place, Kanpur. And so he had started developing a chain to collect flowers from temples and to manufacture very basic level incense sticks from that. But he was having big dreams, like to produce something really innovative from that flower waste. And for that, he was searching for some technical help. And luckily enough, like Kanpur is having IIT, through some channels, he got connected with my supervisor. And my supervisor connected me to Ankit. And of course, I had decided to walk on the R&D path, and so in my mind I was already having very clear plans to join my PhD after I finished up with Master's. But then this thing came up, it was challenging, like completely blank in front of you. You just have the, motive in front of you. Okay, you want to develop something very innovative, some product which can solve some issues, and that from whatever scratch material you have. And I found that problem interesting and decided to tackle it. And even with not having much facility in whatever lab I was working on, still somehow we were successful in carrying out an experiment of manufacturing an alternative for thermopod. So as you know, thermopod is it's a polymer, it's non-biodegradable, it's toxic. And so it's already banned in China, US, and now states have started planning it. So that thought process was, if we can try manufacturing thermopods from flower waste. So we did some experimental things on that and it was a success. And of course, Ankit's business model was really nice. Like he was trying to incorporate women empowerment also. And I had that feeling, okay, the basic thing is I want to do research here. I will be able to do that for sure. Very independently maybe. And the challenging part was in your PhD or in other institutes, maybe you find some guide, superior one, experienced one who can guide you where you are stuck. Here, maybe that is also not going to be the, that was also going to be the situation. I had to figure out whatever comes in my way on my own. So that part, and maybe that's the key I always wanted being in research, to figure out certain problems on some video on my own. So I thought maybe I can take up this venture and try to give it bigger heights, take it to bigger heights, and that is how this all startup came up for me.
And marketing head in university, I would like to ask you about your first experience in marketing. Here you are sending an incident which might teach you something, or it teaches you to pursue marketing.
So I am an engineer myself, and in my college days I was a part of National Entrepreneurship Network, and we had our own Excel. So I used to head the publicity and the event management team over there. Now when I was in the publicity team, we used to go to particular colleges, we used to get entries, we used to go to schools and educate people about the various initiatives that we had taken as an Excel. That is where I understood probably my strengths lay more in interacting with people, meeting new people, understanding their requirements, and communicating with them. So that was my first brush with marketing. That is where I really felt, you know, probably computer science was something that I will finish off as a course, but marketing would be the place that I would want to see myself for the next 20-30 years.
This is for
the
startup, but
what's
the thought that can go into it? This entire project that
I'm having,
I think
you
started it, not something like an
NGO or anything. Yeah, so see, we are in the social impact space. If you were to just understand what social impact is, that you're driving a change through some social initiatives. For us, it is a two-pronged affair. One would be that we collect flowers from temples. We are trying to solve the problem of temple flowers. We are trying to solve the problem of waste generated from temples. The second was we wanted to generate employment for women who are from the marginalized sections of the community. Now, in my experience and in all of our experience, what we have seen is that all social enterprises brand themselves as NGO, and that is where all the mishap happens. If you run a particular organization like a business with a focus on profitability, it is way more feasible and sustainable in the long run. So today we employ about 80 women. The aim is to employ about 5,000 women. Now we won't be able to employ 5,000 women if we don't see some profits which we can invest back into the system. Now when we say we do about 8.5 tons of flowers, which are flower cycled every day, we cannot reach 800 tons or 8,000 tons until the products which we are making out of this waste are not being consumed by a larger population. So if this does not happen, then there is no point of setting up an organization and giving it your time. Until and unless it is tied up with profit and it gets back into the system and the churn happens, that is when we feel that the real change can happen. So in our opinion, social entrepreneurships or social impact startups have to be profit driven to really effect the change. That was the reason why we went for a private limited rather than an NGO.
What was the role of IIT in your startup? Okay, so yeah, of course, IIT KA's role comes to the Green Innovation Center. Or rather, as I had explained in my earlier answer also, the role starts even one step before, when they actually were able to do very basic experimentation in the lab I was working in. Of course, that was an IIT lab, was for lab only, right? And my professor, he was able to guide us a little bit regarding what we were trying to do. So after we could develop a very small, brick-like sample in our early experiments. So we were trying to develop some of our alternative sort of right now, which we call chloroform. So that experiment we had not expected, of course, that eventually something like a real product or going very close to what we had thought that would come up. But lucky enough, maybe we had put enough effort, so we could have our hands on that particular that thing. And when we showed that thing to the committee that handles the SIIC incubation, like whom to incubate, whom to not, and not taking all the permissions. The in charge professor Bandopadhyay, who is from bioscience department, he was really excited to see that product and overall concept, like taking cows from temples and developing something like that. And of course, Ankit, past experiences, he was having a good network. He could put some good points in front of Bandopadhyay, like how he thinks of expanding this business, how he thinks of connecting with some good resources and getting good funding, etc. And of course, the women empowerment part also highlights a lot of things. So because of all these things, the senior people, the professors, they were really excited to have us on board without much constraints. Okay, like it really red carpet was thrown for us. Okay, to come and join. So basically, IIT Kanpur and HelpUsGreen hand in hand can make something big out of this. That was the overall thought process. So we got incubated some almost 10 years back, and more than a year, I would say, 1.5 years. And we have used all the facilities available here, lab space, instrument, and a lot of cooperative support from all the event staff. And so after the efforts of 1 year or so from my team, we have been able to develop Flora form to such a stage which can actually be launched into market, and now the product is commercially viable. Floraform had seen the days of very early experimentation to the stage where it can reach the commercial market. I think very major credit goes to IIT Kanpur.
What was the biggest challenge that you faced in the initial phase of the startup?
I think multiple challenges. One biggest challenge was that people were not really convinced as to what we were doing with us. What is it that two kids are going to do with classes was the question, right? Temple authorities were not really welcoming, because for them, what they had been doing for centuries was just collect these stars and put them in the river, right? So when you go up to a temple authority and say that, you know what, we'll be collecting these stars and we'll make something out of it, that itself was one of the biggest challenges, convincing them that this is something we are really going to do. I mean, there's no other intention with this, and we are trying to solve a problem over here. So that was the first challenge, which we were successful in navigating over a period of time. But I think we are still in the initial stages only. To say that we have been very successful or something would be wrong. In the initial stages that we are in right now, we see problems right from logistics, we see problems right from team management, how to deal with team members. We see problems as to what kind of facilities we need in terms of R&D, and there are many a times that we need certain things which are not available, and then how do you work around it? So it's all a constant struggle, I would say. I mean, if I were to say that we've streamlined the process and we've gotten somewhere, that would be wrong. Of course, we've gotten somewhere, but the challenges are every day. I mean, we go through challenges every single day. There's not one day that goes without a challenge. So yeah, I think that is the takeaway.
So the early stage challenges are quite different. I mean, some of them you mentioned, and some of them I would like to put up this way, like you want to build a team, but of course in the very initial stage, no one really puts that much help in. I mean, let's say right now we do have a R&D team of graduates who have attended their masters from biology department. Of course, the floraform and biological research is more oriented towards the biological field. We needed them. I come from an engineering background. Also, I did some reading, some inspiration part, came up with some protocol, but for higher level things, as I was mentioning, that part was a long one, from very basic prototype to actually commercially viable product. For that, we needed them. Then again, they were having some good opportunities which they would have explored. After masters, actually, joining a well-established R&D lab or some pharma company, something like that. Even if they, so it does not happen in everyone's case, right? Just like they like some venture, they feel that dedication, but in some cases, some person has to think about financial things also. Whatever, maybe the family background, whatever it is. Yeah, exactly. These things also come into the picture. So convincing them to come and go forward, and basically making sure that security everyone feels.
One more problem is that we are in Kanpur. Right? I mean, people come to Kanpur to study and then move out to metros or probably out of India and all. So attracting talent in Kanpur. So I think we have a team from IIT Kanpur. So that team knows what the campus is. But if we were to attract someone from, say, marketing or finance, we need someone for logistics, supply chain. It's quite difficult convincing people come to Kanpur. So we have to think of alternatives as to why they will come on board. So we really have to ensure that the vision that we have is translated very well. It is gone into the system and only then a person comes on board. Because once someone comes on board, we would want that person to stay for a long time. It is very difficult getting someone and then letting that person go and then finding someone else. There's a lot of bandwidth that goes into this. So that is also a constant challenge.
Another thing which actually I have faced, I would like to highlight it, the startup is small or the team size is very small. You have to handle a lot of responsibility. So basically I want to say there is not really a proper allocation about the task. Okay, I am mainly here for handling the R&D and developing the product. But in certain cases, you need to take care of some random job where you personally think your skill set does not lie, or your interest clashes with that particular thing. You don't really want to do that. So yeah, that feeling comes up. Okay, I don't want to do that. Like, yeah, let's say some management related thing. If someone asks me to do that, I might not be interested in doing that, but being a startup, you have to do it when the team is small. Like, just to give an example, when we were in the middle stage of developing our product, it was in good shape that time. And company got to know it through some videos. Ankit had mentioned about product, and we quickly received some contacts. That time we were still in processing about our patents, etc. So as the patent was not filed and the company were asking for samples, we had to be sure, like before sending them, we have to get some non-disclosure agreement type of thing, get signed from them. But of course we were not having some legal person or legal advisor on our team that time. So what I had to do is I had to sit through and consult some people, let's say, or taking some drafts for such kind of documents across internet and prepare a draft for our purpose. That was something which I had not imagined I will ever do. But I had to do that and I'm happy doing that. But that time it was like, oh man, I don't want to do this. Why even I'm doing this? So yeah, these are small things, but yes, that time they do feel like that. So
would you like to share some instances where you were able to convince them that what kind of choice to make of course for example courses currently things that you
I think one very recent example is someone who's doing an internship with us. He comes from an environmental science background, but he's doing an internship in the marketing department where he has a dual role. Now he was pretty clear that he comes from an environmental science role, but he said that I don't know what kind of value addition I'll be able to do. And we really felt that he had the skill set to be in the department and probably, you know, give us some sort of a good output or some value addition. How we were able to convince, as I said, is the same thing, that he feels a lot about the environment. He has a lot of strong understanding of where we are going wrong as a race and so on and so forth. And his aspirations also lie in doing something in the future to help negate the effects of all the bad things that we as a race have been doing. So when we told him that, you know what, it's easy to say these things, it's easy to sit in your house and say I would want to set up something and all, but unless and until there is a market fit for it, until and unless there are consumers who would want to consume what you want to make out of it, or until you actually have something in your mind which the consumers agree with, there's no way that your organization or whatever you have in mind can grow. So when we told him that, that really, you know, lit a bulb in his head, or I don't know what happened, he called us up and said that I would want to go ahead with this, for the simple reason that he sees the same thing. Most of the NGOs or social organizations are failing because of lack of funds, are failing because they are not sustainable. And when he saw that, he understood that why this aspect of the whole organization is also important. That's why he's come on board for a long-term internship, and if things go well, we would want him to continue with us for a longer duration. At the same time, he's also doing a research report and a thesis on the effects of thermopower, plastic and everything. So he's doing both of the things, but as I said, he's ready to juggle both of these with the time that he has. And that's like the biggest achievement we can say in getting people on board, someone who was not from that background but felt he would want to. And the second biggest is we have consumers who are buying our products right now. We have people who are buying our incense sticks and incense cones that we have on our website, and we do a good number of orders every day. If people are seeing products which are made out of temple flowers and waves and empowering women and are ready to buy it in the quantities that they are buying it, I think that's good enough for us in terms of, as an organization, we are able to convince our customers what more do we want.
For your startup, I mean, how difficult it was for you to get funding? It's a problem everyone faces in their startup.
I think Nachiket also has a good idea about it, but I think IIT Kanpur has been pretty helpful in that. The first round of funding or the first initial support that we got from IIT Kanpur, that really helped us. I will not say that it has been easy, it definitely has not. We are now going for a Series A funding and seed funding is done, and we know what kind of efforts are going into it. But the fact that IIT Kanpur is backing us, the fact that SIIC is backing us, the fact that they have been with us for so long and are willing to support us with whatever we need, that really helps us in going out to people, because having someone like an IIT Kanpur as a backer for your organization is not something many organizations can say. So that initial, I would say, turmoil or challenge was negated because of IIT support. And going forward, I think there is a timeline that we have to keep in mind as to when we'll get funding. It does not happen at the snap of your fingers, right? It will take some time, and we are patient enough to go through that process. But the challenges are there.
I would say at least 6-7 months it takes to grab a good funding from an official source, you can say. And so it was about sometimes you do have a good idea, but it is about putting it in front of people. So maybe we were able to model it properly, whatever was going on in the head. That model we were able to prepare properly and put in front of crowd, and that is where you win the investors, I would say.
Also, a very important part is that even if you have picked up investment from someone, you have certain milestones and goals to achieve, without which you cannot really go for the next round of investment. And I think he knows better about the milestones as to how difficult it has been to achieve those milestones. So.
Right, so raising the next round, of course the new investor would look for how efficiently you have completed your milestone with the earlier investment and all that. So yeah, that is altogether a different task to be on your toes to complete milestones and all that. So early stage, I would say one factor played really good, you can say friend circle or through old contacts from this earlier organization, they believe in it. And so that at the very early stage, they put up some angel fund for him, like, okay, you are trying to do something really big and out of the blue. So good support. That played a crucial role, because we could come up with a prototype, you can say. Like, let's say even for incense sticks, Ankit was having a radiation sleep prototype in a very early stage, and that he could showcase to people awareness in like social alpha, support social cause. So, so they could easily come front and basically support us. And then of course I can push forward with them.
Right now, it's the world coming kids with the same idea as a competition to help the team. How would you place it?
Oh, you would be very happy about that, quite honestly. Because the more people who do this, that helps us in two ways. One is it clearly helps the environment. So that was the main aim with which we started, right? It was the main underlying theme that we want to do something which will negate the effect of temple cars going into the rivers. So that never changes for us. For us, it is all the more better. In fact, we would encourage not one but 10 such startups coming into the region, because the problem is too big to be solved in a year by a single organization. It is going to take a lot of time for any organization to have really strong answers to this problem. There's a lot of offshoots. Second, competition breeds innovation. Like, because of competition, there will be so many different things that they bring on the table, which we may not have thought of. So that really helps us, because with our competition, we have that thing that we want to get better, we want to exceed. At this point of time, the only competition we have is us. So we would be happy if more people enter this play and, you know, contribute towards this. Also, it expands the market. They will reach out to a larger set of audiences. We reach out to a certain set of audiences. So because of this, since the market gets bigger, the product gets consumed much more than what you would do as a single organization. So, very happy if more people take up the course.
So, I feel after competition would come up in a sense like people will start doing something from flower. In terms of products, of course, when we have actually good effort, we have made sure in terms of patenting for chloroform, etc., like both will remain legal, that is for sure. So, first of all, you have to create a competition. People have to come up with really something, again, really good innovation, having some really breakthrough product. And if, again, the product is for the society, for the people, and so we are happy to deliver some good products to the society, right? So, something of that level, the product, something. So, it's like things will run in parallel, right? So, right now, what if we have to make some new product, first we have to finish up whatever is in our hand, then move to the next one. If someone is going to come and parallelly build a product, basically if things are going to get to the community, of course we will be glad for that. And people are going to get a breakthrough good product, the thing is to be happy over that. And ultimately, it is a good feeling, you know, to somewhere we have inspired those people. That feeling is good. And ultimately, we will remain the pioneer who have started this thing. That is it. That always remains.
So, having recognized by the United Nations as a coach, so what are your future plans? What is in store for
this business? A lot actually is in store. Our ambitions are quite huge.
I mean, in terms of starting the question with mentioning the awards, in terms of awards and all that, we don't really have any plans right now. I mean, those will eventually come. Okay. So that's fine. So in terms of work, if you are to ask me what's in our store, the first thing is we are in the process of setting up our factory or what is the manufacturing plant for chloroform. As I happen to mention, chloroform is in that stage, like research pad has been completed, and we can actually enter the market now. So the process is completely commercially viable. We can produce chloroform into pulp. Now what we want is the facility where we can actually manufacture it, the instrument and all that. So in the industrial area of Kanpur, we are setting up a factory. So currently, within a month or one and a half month, the factory will get functional. So people will actually be able to see the product. We ourselves will be actually able to see the product into market or going into people's hands. That is our first ambition. And So whatever calculations we have done based on the production capacity, whatever we are setting up, that will not be again completely fulfilling the market requirement. Thermocol has a huge, huge market requirement. It's used in almost each and every packaging. And so if the production that is required for replacing thermocol is in tons, right now we will be producing in kgs for sure. So, but okay, the pilot plant will be functional, and based on that, showing that model, we can think of move on to big cities, where we will be setting up real scale industrial plant and catering to the industrial level, that scale requirements. And of course, the aim will be to replace thermocol all over. At least, let's say, we can target India first. I don't know if you have planned any question about like your wallet and good R&D. I think we have too much to have in the question regarding later in your store, but still, the answer is in these lines only. So I'd like to add, of course, simultaneously, now as the Plurocom R&D is complete, simultaneously, of course, we were working on leather also, but now the pace for leather development has really fastened up, because now the complete focus is on development of bio leather. Next 5-6 months, we'll be having a good protocol for the development of leather. And again, leather is a very polluting industry. If you consider Kanpur itself, yeah, especially Kanpur. So that's something we are planning to do again. Let's go installate something in terms of leather.
Anything else you said? Big ambitions. With leather, which will be more B2B solutions, big ambitions in the B2C sector with the incense sticks and incense spoons. We've reached a high number of orders by now. We're able to change the market in terms of the consumption of incense, ensure the best products get out, launch. We've got about 6 new products which we have already planned, which have hit the production stage also. So,
over here,
many new startups,
many social startups
come up.
So, how
is
your social startup
different from the market? What's your special thought? I really don't know. I mean, what I should say about what is special about our startup. I think what really special is, I think we have a good team now. I really don't know a social startup having a very strong R&D team. In my experience, I am not aware of social startups investing so heavily in R&D. They do invest in human resources, they do invest in all of those things, but there are very few which are so heavily invested in R&D, and I think that really sets us apart, because it would have been easy for us to be an incense stick, incense cone, and consumer products company, but I think the R&D team has given us some really good results by showing us products which can be produced at mass scale and can solve problems at a much more faster pace. So for me, it's probably the R&D team which is the differentiating factor.
And I have to add to this. I would say there are three things. First is, or rather, the compilation of three things itself. Like whatever three things I am going to explain, maybe individually startup might have been taken care of. Compiling them all together was something different. First thing is environment, let's say. So what to do? We picked up some problem which can solve environmental issues, or it can take us to the sustainability thing. That was one. Second is the innovation part. I mean, of course, we started picking up flowers. When we picked up flowers itself, so whatever environmental thing that we were trying to do, that was sorted. I mean, flowers were going to the river water earlier, and they were rotting there for the pesticide, insecticide part remaining on those flowers that are being used to grow them. That is getting mixed with the water bodies, basically polluting the water sources. That was the basic issue. started collecting the flowers itself, that part is taken care of. We could have done, we could have manufactured any simple product out of them. Incense sticks was itself a big leap, and that too, like developing a technology which could produce charcoal free incense sticks. So if we are the incense sticks that is being manufactured has condensed charcoal, our incense sticks does not. That is there. The information there itself is started, of course, no doubt. But we could have skipped to the very basic thing, let's just manufacture manure out of it. I mean, just clean those flowers using some technology, remove the pesticides, etc. Now we have a pure, clean organic pest, and we can set a big plan to just manufacture vermicompost and or manure, you can say. Right now, that product is there in our product lineup, but that is being manufactured as the last resort. I mean, whatever products which have rot already, we cannot use them for some good quality products manufacturing, then that part is used for manual manufacturing. But I think if one has to give a very basic thought process to what to do from flower, I think the simple process that person would have done is, okay, let's manufacture this. So that was something. And then again, it will be used to the something like chloroform. That was second. And of course, third will be due to come the later part. Wherever I have talked about that, chloroform is also okay. People do raise their eyebrows, but still they are like, okay, we can digest that. From flowers to something like chloroform. But when I talk about a leather substitute from flowers, people are like, oh, seriously, that kind of thing. So automatically. And third thing is incorporating the social aspect part into it. Frankly, I mean, right now all the flower sorting part, sorting as in removing the plastic waste that comes with it, all of the best part, searching out the petals, some applications still require that. All of that is taken care of manually by the hands of these women who work with us. So we would have easily done this thing that automate everything. Like, of course, machines are available for everything now. And if we start depending on machine, I think we can raise our production capacity to a higher level very fast. But of course, that is a trade-off. Like, if one has to think on a business line, that is a trade-off. But we have decided to stick to the social aspect. We will stick to that one. We have found the solution, like the answer to that particular trade-off. And that is something which again separates us from all other. When you start seeing business, you take some decisions which help you grow it, I suppose. Yeah, business is money, right? So yeah, but still we are trying to stick to those ethical norms or whatever we started with, those principles. And combining these three things, our business model stands out.
So, being such successful entrepreneurs, would you like to give some message to the future entrepreneurs and the ones who are really interested in the audience?
I think you were one of those. I think the best time to start is right now. There's no better time to start your own thing than right now. If you have something in your head, go for it, fail fast, and learn from it. I think there's no better opportunity that you'll get at this juncture, at least in India, than to start your own thing. Be it from IIT, be it from any other organization, be it from any other. You can be someone who has an idea, and if you really feel about it, just start. Don't wait for that paycheck which will come in, which will give you some social security or something. Don't do that. Start karo. Fail hue to theek. If it doesn't fail, you learn. That's the only idea or probably advice I would give. There's a lot that can be done. We are a nation of a billion people. There are a billion problems that can be solved. So just go for it. I don't have any other advice. Not clearly things that.
I would say the same thing, like if you really have that something in you, I mean, you having some idea, let's say, like try to get out of their comfort zone. I understand their comfort zone part, and of course there is a lot of struggle when you are thinking about a startup and early stage. You cannot see the horizon, no future picture. I completely understand that, but that is how it moves forward. If you like, what you say, get stuck with that comfort zone right now, I think at a later stage, very few people at a very later stage they break those norms that time when they again start with something and all that, but it is not, it does not remain like a very unique task for everyone at a later stage. But this time we do have the energy, we do have those thoda bhaga duri karne wala and all that. So I think it's a time, and it's like jaldi aage cheez hai type of thing. Of course, right now you will not feel it. Okay, the corporate job, good package and settlement and all that. But if you struggle right now, of course you have to give it some time and all that. But once you stand on that and you look that side, then the picture is really nice. That's what I can see. So just if one can keep this in mind too, that he wants to see the picture on that other side, then just with that curiosity, I think one can start. So, I mean, that feeling after putting up all the efforts, after the struggle, when you see that you have actually given these to your dream, there is nothing like that.
Also, I think one really important thing which people may miss out on, or they may not, is that really focus on building a good team. Ideas are dime a dozen, everyone has the same idea. I sit in your may have the idea, the person behind the camera may have the same idea, but it's in the successful execution of the idea that really takes you places. So the most important factor that we have seen is that it takes a lot of iterations to get your team right, but once you get your team right, nothing can stop you. I think focus and invest a lot in building the right team. Once that is done, the team will take you places.
Future and your startup has to be
Thank you so much. Thank you.